Beloved family and friends, welcome to Covenant House Church. It's the fifth Sunday after the Epiphany, February 7th, 2021. We invite you to light your Christ candle because we are connected through the light of Christ, and it's house church. We are connected from home to home. And if you haven't already done so, I would invite you to prepare your elements for the sacrament of Holy Communion. Arise, shine, for your light has come, and the light has not and will not ever overcome the darkness. Dear friends, today our participants include Mary and Dave, who are our liturgists, Rebecca, who will be leading us in the blessing of children of all ages. I will be presiding for the prayers of the people, and Miriam will be sharing with us reading and reflecting on the words from Mark chapter 1, verses 29 through 39. Let us worship God.
The Call to Worship from Psalms for Praying by Nan Merrill, based on Psalm 147. Praise the Beloved, heart of all hearts. We are blessed as we sing blessings to the Beloved.
For as we give ourselves to love, so we receive love. The Beloved abides in our heart, in every open heart that welcomes love.
Through love, we are sent to the brokenhearted, a mutual balm to the soul. We seek out the downtrodden, those without shelter or food, recognizing our own poverty with them.
Those in prison also await willing hearts to visit them, that forgiveness might free all from bondage.
Sing to the Beloved with thanksgiving. Mingle with the melody of the spheres. Awaken to your inheritance in all the universe, for you belong to heaven, to the stars and galaxies.
You also come from earth, from mineral and plant. Pure water courses through your veins. For every creature, those that swim and fly and walk on land know you as of old.
And each human in body and spirit welcomes you in the heart song of love, where we know we are all one being.
Praise the beloved, life of all life. Invite love into your heart, for divine love gives strength to the weak with courage to face their fears.
Thank you. Hi, Covenant kids. A lot of you might not know who I am, but my name is Becca, and I'm also a Covenant kid. Pastor Mark and Pastor Mimi are my parents, and we kind of live far away. We're all the way up in Traverse City, and I'm here with my husband, Alan, and this is our daughter, Aurora. And of course, we have our little puppies here. We have Sky and Sage. And we haven't been able to come down to Covenant in a long time like many of you, but we feel very connected because we have cute little boots for Aurora from Tina Root. And Miss Cora Benson Root was kind enough to share some clothes with Aurora. And I'm wrapped in love from Sue Tracy. And we have all sorts of connections because even though we're far away, we love each other all from all sorts of different places. And today, we wanted to share one of our favorite books with you. And it's about a little word that changed the world and helped us all stay connected. The story of And. The little word that changed the world. There once was a girl who loved to count. She counted the cracks in the sidewalk, the clouds in the sky, and the stars at night. Most of all, she loved to count the word and in every story she read. "What a waste of time," said her neighbor. "Be serious," said her principal. "Stop dilly-dallying," said her parents. She couldn't convince anyone that counting and wasn't silly until the day she started reading an old story and everyone listened. Down a dusty road, a circle rolled along, feeling all alone with all its edges gone. Then circle bumped into a single line. Could this somehow be a secret sign? But Line thought Circle was a wreck. "You don't even have a neck." But over the hill came the small word and, so simple and sure, saying, "Yes, we can." She joined their hands. "Together you'll bloom into a glowing red balloon. When you gather more than three, what a party it will be." Triangle sat alone on the ground, making all her very angled sounds. A rectangle scooched up with a grumbling noise. "You're a silly, almost trapezoid." She was hurt by what he said, and she scratched her pointy head. But over the hill came the small word and, so simple and sure, saying, "Yes, we can." She joined their hands. "There is no flaw. Together you can be a seesaw. One side goes up and one side goes down, and many seesaws make a playground." Once there was a solitary square, thumping along as quickly as he dared. Triangle slid up all full of pride, saying, "Hey, you have a useless side." Square was stung by what she said, and he almost turned and fled. But over the hill came the small word and, so simple and sure, saying, "Yes, we can." She joined their hands. "Have no doubt. The two of you can build a house, and then many houses together be a neighborhood." Line went marching down the street, so very proper and so very neat. When he saw Oval in a flower bed, he laughed and said, "You're such an egghead." Oval acted mad, 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 but inside she was simply sad. Then over the hill came the small word and, so simple and sure, saying, "Yes, we can." She joined their hands. "See what I wrote? Together you can make a note. And when many notes relate, what a lovely song it makes." Octagon sat upon a mat and was tipped his little eight-sided hat. A cylinder rolled up to one side. "You couldn't rock and roll if you tried."
Octagon got really upset. Those words made him start to fret. But over the hill came the small word and, so simple and sure, saying, "Yes, we can." She joined their hands. "You are able. The two of you can be a table." And when people gather round, a new community is found. To create a world without a missing piece, all the different shapes make us complete. I am I, and you are you. This is really nothing new. But remember, it's a fact. We are stronger back to back to back. When we meet someone different from us and we are tempted to make a fuss, look for our friend, the small word and, so simple and sure, saying, "Yes, we can." She joins our hands and shows us how to trust. Then you and I can become us. What wonders there can be when you and I are we, family. The end. Bye, kids.
Rebecca, thank you for sharing the blessing of the children with us. Let's bless children of all ages by singing the blessing, God is love. Peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Confession. Everlasting God, we know how easy it is to forget your presence and power in our lives. Focused on our daily planners, we do not pay attention to the night sky and the stars that glitter. Surrounded by the sounds of violence, anger, and hate, we have trouble listening to your whispers of hope and grace. Thinking that Scripture is filled only with stories, we cannot understand your truth, which can change lives.
Forgive us. There is no one who can hold a candle to you when it comes to mercy and hope. Lift us to our feet so we may walk with you. Fill us with your strength so we may serve your people. Touch us with your healing so we may proclaim to everyone the good news that has come in Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen.
The words of assurance. Haven't you been listening? The good news is this. God never tires out. God is always with us. God heals us with mercy. God strengthens us for service. The one who numbers the stars knows each of us by name. Thanks be to God, we are forgiven. Amen.
The Guide for Faithful Living. Those who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint.
Chairman of Deacons at Covenant, please pray with me. Like the disciples at Emmaus, we offer all that we have. They offered their company, their table, their bread. We invite you to be with us, Jesus, as we offer our love, our devotion, and these gifts. May our eyes be open to your holy presence among us, now and always.
Dear friends, please join me in the prayers of the people. You lift us up to the heights, Holy One. On wings like eagles, you enable us to soar with the possibilities of revolution, of transformation, both within our own souls and within this world, which needs so much care. And yet it is not the bright skies where we most often live. We are here with our feet on the ground, your feet planted firmly beside us as we try to walk without fainting, walk through the shadows of death and ill health and addiction, walk through life changes, moves, births, aging, loss. We need your strength to not grow weary as we continue to hope for new life amidst old attitudes and injuries. We long to run and not grow faint as we challenge demeaning political tirades that seep into our daily encounters, as we work for your compassion and wholeness for all people and all creatures and the very earth. Lift us up to the heights, Holy One, so we may again catch a glimpse of the vast possibilities of your shalom, even as we pray for it here, right here on earth. Amen. Today, Miriam will be reading and reflecting on Mark, the Gospel of Mark, chapter 1, verses 29 through 39. I think this is the third straight week we're looking at the first chapter of Mark. Let's prepare our hearts for the reading and reflecting on the Word of the Lord by singing God of the Word. Out of the babble that surrounds us, out of the chaos that's within, where can we go to find our meaning? Is there a place we can begin?
Everyone. So did you hear the story about the mother-in-law? I should be careful doing anything about mother-in-laws because I never knew my mother-in-law. And I am a mother-in-law now. And I know there's a lot of jokes about mother-in-laws. So did you hear the story about the mother-in-law and Jesus? Here's the story. Well, first of all, I want you to hit your pause button and go get your Bible, because we're gonna do a little bit of a Bible study like in the olden days of me and the Covenant Women. On Monday mornings, we would get our Bibles and we would go through maybe 1, 2, maybe 10 verses together. So there you go, hit your pause button. Okay, are you back now? Got your Bible? We're gonna read through this together, a little bit like that Bible class, Bible study that we had. Okay, so turn to Mark chapter 1. A little review, because every time we had to review, okay, where have we been? What have we talked about? We remembering that this is the Gospel of Mark. Pastor Mark did not write this, but he could have. But this is the Gospel according to Mark. It's the first Gospel that we have written, even though it comes second in the order. And it's the oldest and it's the shortest Gospel. And in this first verse, this first chapter, rather, it begins, this is the beginning of the good news, it says. And we read the story about John the Baptizer and Jesus getting baptized, and then he quickly goes off to the desert where the angels minister to him, and he is there in very short about being tempted there. And then it quickly goes on to Jesus saying, the time is now fulfilled. The kingdom of God is near. Repent and believe the good news. Pastor Mark preached about that a few weeks ago. And then Pastor Mark preached about the next little bit, calling the fishermen, Simon and Andrew and James and John, and my Mark had his fishing vest on. And then last week, it was this little story that took place in Capernaum on the Sabbath day when Jesus was teaching there, and there was a possessed by evil spirit man who showed up. He shouldn't have been there, because if he was demon-possessed, he was not part of the community. But he showed up and Jesus cast out that demon. So this is all happening. A lot of quick, fast things are happening in the Gospel of Mark. So today, when we look at Mark chapter 1, verse 29, it's the same day. It's the same day. So let's imagine together and wonder and listen for these words, and we're going to go through it together. So I don't know what translation you have, but here we go. As soon as they left the synagogue, remember it's still the Sabbath, they entered the house of Simon and Andrew with James and John. Okay, so Simon's house is in Capernaum. Simon has a house. He's a homeowner. And his brother lives with him? Okay, so I wonder about that household. Were they brothers together? Well, it says, now Simon's mother-in-law was in bed with a fever. So Simon's mother-in-law lived with him and Andrew and supposedly Simon's wife. So I wonder about this household a little bit. What made it up? And was it normal for a mother-in-law to come and live with her son-in-law? I don't know. I might have to move to Traverse City. A mother-in-law living there, and she was in bed with a fever, and they told him about it at once. At once. Why at once? Was it to explain why she wasn't up and around? Was it because they expected Jesus to do something? I wonder, what was it at once? So, what did he do? He came and took her by the hand and lifted her up. Then the fever left her and she began to serve them. Now, I don't know about you, but if I've been sick and not feeling well and start to recover, I don't think I would be real pleased with a house full of people and then having to get up and take care of them. In some translations, we have some different language. Maybe your translation has a little bit of a different language, so I wonder what yours says. Some say he came and took her by the hand and helped her up. Some translations say he took her by the hand and raised her up. Well, that word, whatever, however it's translated, that word lifted up or helped up or raised up, it's the same word used for the raising of Lazarus. It's the same word used by the gospel writers of Jesus' resurrection, raised up, brought back to life, restored health and enlivenedness, if that's even a word. So Jesus raised her up. Oh, it's kind of a resurrection story. It's kind of like even that story with the man in the synagogue earlier in the day, casting out the demon and restoring to wholeness, to bring life, his true life, back to him. So he came and took her by the hand and resurrected her in some ways, and the fever left her. Some writers, scholars say the fever left her as if it was a kind of almost like an evil spirit, which back in those days, if you were sick, it was kind of sometimes attributed to some evil in you or a spirit that's taken hold of you. And so the fever left her, even kind of like that demon that was cast out of the man earlier. And she began to serve them. Now, in some translations, it says she went back to her work for the day. Or she carried on. But here again, the word, she served them, it's the word for deacon. It's the word that is used later when deacons are made in the early church. She began to be the first deacon. This mother-in-law was the first deacon. And just like Jesus had called Simon and Andrew and James and John, she began to serve in the service of Jesus as a deacon. I kind of like that. The first deacon woman at Covenant was Jean DeWitt, Ken DeWitt's mom, a deacon serving. Well, this story in Mark keeps racing right along. Here's the whole gospel in some ways, right here, when Jesus raised someone up and they, in return, began to serve. That cycle, being brought to life and service. Okay, so the story goes on. That evening at sundown, that means it's the end of the Sabbath, because a day was from sundown to sundown. And so now it's no longer sundown. Jesus healed a couple people on the Sabbath. That was not necessarily a good thing in the eyes of the religious people. But now it's sundown. And they brought to him all who were sick. I'm not sure exactly who they are, if it was the disciples or who is they. I don't know. They brought to him all who were sick and possessed with demons. The whole city. Now remember, this is evening. The sun's going down. It's starting to get dark. And the whole city was gathered around the door. And he cured many who were sick with various diseases and cast out many demons. Well, why not all? I don't know. But here it is, sundown. It's getting dark. And I think in the Middle East, it gets dark. When the sun goes down, it gets darker even sooner. And the whole city is gathered around the door. He cured many sick, cast out demons, and he would not permit the demons to speak. Why? Because they knew him. Ooh, that is a weird thing to say. Earlier, that demon that he cast out earlier in the day, because I know who you are. How is it that those demons knew Jesus and somehow others couldn't recognize him? Something to wonder about. Does evil just know exactly what goodness looks like? So I imagine Jesus being really tired, and Simon and Andrew and the whole household. It's been a busy day. Tired. Story races on. In the morning, while it was still very dark, he got up and went out to a deserted place, and there he prayed. Here's a model. Often we think of that with Jesus getting up early to go off by himself to pray, but it's the model of action and contemplation, of working and praying. Both are needed. And so Jesus gets up early when it's still very dark. I would not be the one to be doing that. But he got up very early to have some solitude. And Simon and his companions hunted for him. Oof, It's kind of a strong word in there. They hunted for him. And when they found him, they said, everyone's searching for you. In other words, what are you doing? What are you doing out here? You got to be available to people. He answered, let us go to the neighboring towns so that I may proclaim the message. That I may proclaim the message there also. For that's what I came to do, to proclaim the message. And so he went out throughout Galilee proclaiming the message in the synagogues and casting out demons. That's what he came to do, proclaim the message. What's the message? What do you think the message is? Jesus didn't come proclaiming, I'm the one, believe in me. No, in the beginning of this gospel, according to St. Mark, the kingdom of God is at hand. The kingdom of God, or the rule of God. What's the rule of God? Turn around and believe the good news. What is the good news? What is the message? What would you say the message of Jesus? Well, in another gospel writer, Luke, he says that Jesus was in his hometown and he opened the book of Isaiah and he read from the book of Isaiah from the scroll, the Spirit of the Lord is on me and has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor, to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives and release to prisoners, to comfort all who mourn. The message, the good news message, is in some ways encapsulated right in that mother-in-law story of raising individuals up, enlivening them, bringing them to life. And then the response is they become followers and servers of that gospel ministry. St. Francis, who's attributed to saying, preach the gospel always, and if necessary, use words. Now, last week, Pastor Mark talked about the importance of words, and so they are. Our words are very important, and Jesus' words were very powerful, but his actions were just as powerful. And they were just as much the gospel proclamation in raising individuals up. So, friends, if we would be followers of Jesus, not just walking behind him, not just believing in what he said, but doers of what he did, as he called us to do, then we too are to raise people up, or to bring new life, or even the act of resurrection, bringing new life, restoring life to individuals. Now here's the thing. When that man who was possessed by the spirit, and when this mother-in-law who was sick with the fever, and the woman who Jesus healed much later, and the centurion servant, all of them, because they were sick, because they may have had leprosy, they were excluded from the community. They were in quarantine. They couldn't have personal contact with anybody else. I don't know if they had masks then, but they had to stay away from each other. The good news is Jesus restored people to life, and in so doing, restored community. So I have to do a little self-examination. maybe you two too. How are we restoring one another? By our words and by what we do. How are we raising each other up and in so doing, restoring community? Not just for covenant community, but for a wider community where you live and where you work. I have to ask myself, how are my words, gospel, good news, how do they bring life or take life? And how are my actions, whether it's dropping off a meal for someone, or it's making a phone call to someone, or it's creating a kind of culture within my family or my work environment, by my words and by my actions, how am I bringing to life so that the community can be restored? Friends, the good news is the rule of God is near. What's the rule of God, this kingdom of God? One of my good friends says it's the rule of love. It's the rule of love. May we be like this mother-in-law, and may we be restored in health and brought alive in all ways, shape, and form, so that we may be deacons, servers of God, servers of the rule of love. Amen.
As we celebrate the Sacrament of Holy Communion this day, we like to begin with a meaning of the sacrament. The meaning of the sacrament today was written by Pastor Jim Foster, a relative of Tim Lehman, a child of Covenant Church, when they observed the passing of Tim's son Keith at Covenant Church a couple years ago. And Pastor Jim shared this reflection on that communion at that amazing service. The Lord's Supper embodies a realm where justice and mercy and equality and absolute grace prevail. That's what I saw at Keith's funeral. For about an hour, watching ritual unfold to allow wizards and Civil War soldier reenactors, fairies and suits, preachers, and those beautiful ladies in their crazy gowns and hoop skirts, all sitting together and lining up for communion, and after the service, helping each other to ham sandwiches. I will never forget that image, not ever. How often do you get a glimpse of what heaven looks like, even if it's for only an hour? Dear friends, this speaks to the very DNA of Covenant Church. Please hold that in your heart as we continue with this sacrament.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right for us to give thanks and praise.
With joy we praise you, gracious God, for you have created heaven and earth and made us in your image and kept covenant with us, even when we fell away. We give thanks for Jesus Christ our Lord, who by his life and death and resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. Therefore, we join our voices with all of the saints and angels and the whole creation to proclaim the glory of your name.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna in the highest.
We give thanks to God that our Savior, Jesus Christ, before he suffered, gave us this memorial of his sacrifice until he comes again. At the Last Supper, the Lord Jesus took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me."
In the same way, he took the cup after supper and said, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this for the remembrance of me. For whenever we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again."
Christ has died, Christ has risen, Christ will come again.
Lord our God, send your Holy Spirit so that this bread and cup may be for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. May we and all your saints be united with Christ and remain faithful in hope and love. Gather your whole church, O Lord, into the glory of your kingdom. We pray in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray. Our Father and Mother in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Amen.
All glory, power, and praise are yours. Alleluia. Amen.
Jesus invited all to come to the table, without exception. There was no need to prove worthiness. It was only by grace. All who were hungry, all who needed, were welcome at the table. So, come and be as Christ would receive you, welcoming all.
Amen. Miriam, the body of Christ.
Amen.
And the blood of Christ.
Mark, the body of Christ given for you.
Thanks be to God.
And the cup of Christ offered for you.
Bless the Lord, O my soul. Praise God's holy name. Remembering God's benefits, God's mercy we proclaim.
Thanks be to God.
Amen. Amen.
I knew.
May you be at peace. May your heart remain open. May you become enlivened and awake to the nature of your true being, God's beloved. May you be healed and restored in all ways, and may you be a healing, restoring presence to all of creation, to all of life. Amen. In the name of the Creator, and the Christ, and the Holy Spirit, the Comforter. Go in peace.